for yet another Wednesday evening. A rather special show for us, in case you haven't noticed. We've got a new desk, yes. And it's pretty exciting.
And we'd just like to thank the gentle touch for lending one of
them. It's a bit velour, isn't it?
It's a bit brothel.
It was actually funded by...
Hang on, how do you know, Rob?
Yeah. Yeah.
Hey. I saw your photo album. You just don't stick your neck out like that. You know you're going to get it smacked in.
That'll do, and you should learn your lesson. A busy week as always, lots to talk about. Let's meet those who will be doing the talking this evening, including Mr. Glenn Robbins.
Thank you very much.
How are you, Glenn?
I'm very well, thanks, Rob.
That's nice.
Yep.
Also joining us, a man who this week was named Best Director at the prestigious Zimbabwe International Film Festival.
Hey, get that quiet.
No, you think I'm joking. The prestigious bit, yeah, sure, that was a bit of a joke, but Zimbabwe. By the way, Robbie, for the castle, well done, Rob.
Oh, yes. This is how press... We thought it was a practical joke.
Yes, exactly.
And why do you think that's funny? Well, Zimbabwe's a country, is it not, Kate?
Zimbabwe's a country. It's a comedy country.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean... Yeah. When we got a letter from the Australian High Commission saying the organisers of a film festival can't track down the people they're trying to award.
Yeah, it was a little dubious.
No, the funny bit was that they actually need the award back for next year.
There's only one to go around. Also joining us, the ever unpredictable Kate Langbrook. Welcome along, Kate.
Thank you.
And, of course, down the far end, Mr. Santo
Thank
Chilaro.
You. And Kate's got the Zimbabwe look in her head.
Yeah, I do.
She persists.
Yeah. Can I just say quickly, I had a nightmare last night. I dreamt I was part of the Australian cycling team.
That's
a kooky bunch, aren't they?
Oh, seriously. I've got a new name for a villain in Friday the 13th, Lucy Tyler Lewinsky.
Yes. Now, that is spooky. And it leads us into, of course, the big Clinton breakthrough this week was the four-hour tape of his testimony.
You know, when it first started, I wanted him to come on and go, previously on Clinton.
Like a mini-series.
Like how about this for interesting kind of stuff? Now, I was looking at the ratings in the United States for the actual tape, and CBS, apparently it was a bit of a disappointment. It wasn't as big as they thought. CBS had exactly the same ratings as they would have got on normal daytime television, which was soaps.
Is that right?
So it's sort of got the same feel. Like, I think 22.5 million Americans saw this, as opposed to 66.7 million that saw the Address to the Nation on August the 17th, after he gave the...
Losing a bit of interest.
I thought they pulled a pretty good shifty, though. He goes, you're going to see the legendary Clinton temper and all that kind of thing. Yeah. And when you watch it... 4 hours.
Yeah.
The best idea they had was to actually release it, not release snippets, but release the whole thing.
Yes, exactly, because who was going to wait, apart from Glenn, I think, who was in the office today waiting through all 4 hours looking for a juicy... What were you doing?
No, actually, I think he's been advised by our own Magda Zhabansky, because have a look at Clinton, I think, here.
This is the actual 4-hour testimony.
I'm not going to answer your trick questions.
Okay, now let's have a look at Magda on something stupid.
Don't try your chickies.
Yes.
Shins on me.
You have to pay that. That's what you were doing for 4 hours today, obviously.
But the thing about the speech went for 4 hours, but the countdown to the speech.
If anyone's on cable television, CNN was just going.
Ladies and gentlemen, only 13 hours left to go before...
And the first 45 minutes was just the guy setting up the video monitors and stuff, and there were like 40 of them, and the sound quality was pathetic. So I don't know what they were doing.
Well, I think they wanted to keep it like a porno movie. They wanted to have that quality.
Speaking of porno, I reckon it was the emails. They printed a few of them in the paper today from Monica that were... I think they're the most interesting. She obviously started to lose a little bit. It began all, I really want to see you and thank you for buying me, whatever, the presents and stuff, and then it just started to getting more and more sinister as she was demanding to see him. And I was thinking, if it was a Hollywood movie, and it probably will be fairly soon, what the plot would have been surely is the president slept with her, now he wants her dead. It would have been, surely that's what you would have done. You would have, once you realised she was going a little Tyler Sharman, you would have got in there and just taken her out,
proves to me that the president doesn't really order US Navy SEALs into...
Exactly.
Because when you read her letters to Bill Clinton, I mean, they're not exactly hero facts, is that? When you read them, you go, this person is, like, intimidating the president and threatening him.
Yeah. She's so obsessed with him, she's close to being
a terrorist.
Yes. Yes.
I mean, he could have ordered a cruise missile attack on her home.
Yes, and he hasn't.
And he would have in a movie, exactly. Yeah.
In a movie he would have, and he didn't.
And Linda Tripp would have found out of that.
One of their best sessions, apparently, was after he'd fallen down the stairs.
He'd done his knee.
And he was doing long crutches. I mean, that's a trick.
I reckon he's winning back the respect of the American
Absolutely.
They're going, man, the guy can do. He's very good.
I think, like, when I watched that Clinton thing, my mind sort of changed about him when I watched that. I didn't watch the whole 4 hours. But I just couldn't believe that we were watching it.
I couldn't believe we were getting to see it. When you're a kid, you get a magnifying glass and you burn ants.
Yeah.
It was getting red and sweaty. And
Well, actually, if you change channels on Sky or something, it was like they actually turned up the red.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. So he looked really flushed.
So he looked like he was just getting going.
And there was a body language expert in the paper today who was talking about he was doing that, which really shows that you're trying to keep people out. It's a very telling sign as well, mopping the brow and swallowing constantly.
And the pervy factor is so pathetic, I cannot believe it. Like, just these 60-year-old men, this panel of 60-year-old men pretending they've never had their dick sucked, going...
She's gone all Tyler Sharman.
That comment represents pathetic.
A changing of the guard.
I think in the case of Kenneth Starr, he possibly hasn't enjoyed
But like the 2,700 pages explaining what those sexual acts mean, it's like, who are they kidding?
No, it's just school holidays and mums and dads going, ooh, is that the time? Kids off to bed now, I think.
I'm still thinking about Tom saying Monica Lewinsky like she's gone all loose at Tyler Sharman, just going, yeah, well, they said that I'm going to get sacked, but I slept with the presents. Ha ha ha.
Exactly. Sorry, I could go on about that psyche thing.
No, go on.
Because that's like you got your feet like bolted to these pedals, and people are going, well, and it happened with Shane Kelly. It happens with this. And they go, and the mechanics are standing there going like this, and you're going, it's bolt them.
I know,
you can actually make balloons stick to your hair.
It was a little bit all strange, but as you say, that cycling team has just been racked
by.
Yeah, I think that is
fine. Did anyone watch the closing ceremony? Because I didn't. No. I was watching Clinton. But
the king was very red faced, apparently.
The king. They don't look like they got their finger on the pulse, do they? The Malaysian Royal Family. And no, the protesters. Inside, they were only getting like 20,000 people, but outside the protesters, they had 60,000 people. And had they redirected them, they could have gone, and now the protesters from Northern Malaysia.
Why did he have one more day to go where all the world was going, Malaysia, what a great country, and he decided
I think he just lost interest.
And wanted to spice things up. Well, I mean, you've got to be careful, because Keating called Dr. Mahathir recalcitrant a few years ago and caused a huge diplomatic row. I'm not saying he's recalcitrant, but he's a knucklehead, because let's face it, why would you have waited all that, you know, to the last day?
Yeah, when the world's cameras are there.
Exactly. Let people go.
Well, Channel 9's cameras.
Right. Well, true. Yeah. But that's
Ray was there.
He could have solved it. He solved the Papua New Guinea.
Exactly.
He
could have been there. True. The Queen arrived. Did you see the Queen driving through? She actually drove through the one of the riots and doing a bit of the hand wave.
Confusing.
Tiananmen Square. Hi, how are you?
Darling, they're actually trying to overthrow the government. She's lost interest, though, hasn't she, in the Commonwealth? They drag her out to all the countries that she rules, and she goes...
When are they going to become a republic?
Exactly. Get on with it.
She's more of a Republican than our current prime minister.
She's pushing for it. I can't blame her. We might take a very quick break because we've got several special guests tonight. Up next, Commonwealth Games commentator Nicole Stevenson will be joining us right here on the panel. I'm afraid it's over for another 4 years. Yes, the Commonwealth Games, a bit of a triumph. Aussie gold everywhere you looked. Great telecast, held together by quite a few people. But for us, you can forget Ray, you can forget Eddie, you can even forget Ken. It was this woman who held it all together. Former Olympic medalist, would you please welcome Nicole Stevenson. For the riots?
Yeah, I didn't see any of them, but it was funny in '88 when we were there in Seoul for the Olympic Games. There was rioting going on there as well, and everyone made a really big deal about it, but we didn't see any of it, the student uprising. But
you were too busy doing the birdie dance, wasn't '88 the year of the birdie dance?
That was 1990, and thank God it didn't happen this time.
Can I ask you, Nicole? Is that a Laurie Lawrence idea? Because it looks like a Laurie Lawrence idea to me.
No, I don't think it was.
Okay, now I won't talk about the birdie dance incident.
What was the mood in the village? Because was it like, you know, you're an Australian, you know, quit wrecking it, you're hogging all the medals and stuff. Give someone else a go.
Well, I mean, I didn't get to go into the village, but at the pool, I think it was about the fifth day, we didn't win a medal in the women's 200 IM. Mm. And one of the cameramen said to me, there's going to be an inquiry into this event. And I'd gone, why? Because we didn't win a medal.
Yeah. Exactly.
I thought, I'm going to get the pommies on this. And I said it to them. I'm like, why? I said, because Australia didn't win a medal. But they were really happy on the fifth day to hear some other anthems.
Yes.
And did you feel like diving in the pool and going, I might get one of those medals?
No.
Or the poolside interviews afterwards, were you ever tempted to kind of go with some of the athletes?
Like that, exactly. Dividing our nation.
There she is, our lady of the poolside. Yes, Madam Smartass.
Susie, you did a really great job. That's the first thing I heard last night when I got in from the airport. Your promo.
Oh,
thanks, Rob.
You did do a great job. I tell you, you're a killer. You're a natural for it.
Yeah. Oh, you just like it.
I love Nicole. I always have.
That? What do you want me to say to that?
I don't know.
Isn't Susie O'Neill great?
Well, I don't like her, but yeah. But I know she's great. She's incredible, and I have this view that anybody that gets up at 5 o'clock in the morning to swim up and down a pool for, what, how long did you do it for, 15 years?
Yeah, about 16 years.
I mean, that must be the toughest sport.
Yeah, it is. It's a really hard sport. And for someone like Susie that's been on the national team for 10 years and succeeding like she has in everything, I mean, Olympic gold, World Championship gold, Commonwealth gold, and she's really chasing the world record now. So for someone like her, that's a great role model both in and out of the water as well for young kids. I mean, she's just fantastic.
You started when you were 15?
First national team when I was 13.
Did you still go in the school sports? You must have shed a load in the school sports.
Yes. Parkdale High School, I was in Monash, which was colour green.
Right.
Yeah. And, we used to win our relays.
Absolutely. And what? And speaking of 13-year-olds, what about the diving kid?
Wasn't he great?
He was. You expect him to wear floaties as he jumps in the
yes,
water.
Yes, he wasn't that old.
And what I kept on thinking is that wouldn't it be great for his gold medal for it to be the one with the chocolate in the middle?
That's bizarre. Yeah. The poolside interviews were an absolute highlight because you were knowledgeable. You weren't just some idiot shoving a microphone in. And you must have felt like occasionally saying, Climmy, shocker, you know, what's your story?
I mean, it's really hard because I know most of them. So it's really hard to I guess, get the point across of what other people want to hear. It gets very technical, swimmer talking swimmer. I mean, we have our own language. Yes. So.
Well, when you said lactate at one point.
I know, and I got rubbish for it. And what else, Glenn?
Why should you be rubbish?
Well, now, is it Prince Albert, Prince Edward?
Do you know Prince Albert's the head of the Monegestrian Swimming Federation?
I did, actually.
did you call Prince Edward Prince Albert?
I did.
Well, at least you didn't call him Prince Valiant or something.
But could you see where I was going?
No.
Balding, princely, yes. And bachelor.
A Prince Albert is a piercing.
Is what?
Is a piercing.
What's that mean?
A penis piercing.
Okay.
No, it truly is.
A Prince
Albert.
A new disc.
It's called a Prince Albert.
I'd like to say hello to my nieces.
I'd like to know what you're watching now.
Really, it's getting late for bed. Let's pop off to bed now.
But there were some great performances there. At the pool.
What would you rank as the highest?
Well, of course, Susie O'Neill.
Oh, I'm not her again.
Okay. Let me bring some youngsters into it that I think did really, really well. And that's the first one, Simon Cowley. He won the 100 and 200 metres breaststroke double. And he's a Sydney sider. And I really think that this kid could win an Olympic gold medal in the year 2000 without putting too much pressure on him. But this is him winning the 200 metres breaststroke. Ryan Mitchell was in front the whole way. And Cowley, this was his second gold medal. He's such a young, introverted person. Yeah. And that reaction was just fantastic. That's and the time's just brilliant. Yeah. He finished fourth at the World Championships this year, so he's just getting better and better.
What about Thorpe and Hackett and those kind of guys?
Great racing. I mean, Ian Thorpe, he's only 15 years of age. Size 16 feet, don't we hear that all the time?
Yeah, what I can't get over, they're all likeable kids. I mean, we had Brad Hackett on the show one night. He was just a tremendous kid.
Yeah, they're all really great guys. I mean, he missed the world record by 0.01 in that 200 freestyle, which, as Ray Warren said, just isn't fair.
Why? He missed it.
Can I ask quickly, everyone I ever speak to that goes to an Olympics or goes to... One of the people, everyone comes up and goes, oh, you lucky thing, I'd love to do it. But it really is hard work, isn't it?
It really is hard. The amount of pressure that you're not only placing yourself, you get one day every 4 years at an Olympics or a Commonwealth Games to get it right.
Mm.
Yeah. If you make a mistake, you miss a world record by 1/100th, or you miss a medal, or you miss a final. So it really is pressure packed.
No, I was talking about commentator. I genuinely was.
Yeah, that's hard.
No, but it is hard. Everyone I speak to, I ask, and they say, look, you know, like Bruce McAvaney went to the Olympics and he said, you know, he was sleeping on the concrete underneath the 2 hours before the heats and the finals.
Dare I say it's harder than swimming. Sorry.
Yeah, no, go ahead.
It is. Because basically the swimmers are so focused, they're not aware of what's any problems that might be occurring you know, they get to have their nice little sleep during the day in between heats and finals, mm-hmm. and we're sleeping on concrete floors in between heats and finals.
What's going to happen to someone like Daniel Kowalski now? I was rooting for him
I really wanted him to get
like the bronze so badly.
Let's not forget that he still broke a world record there. He still won a Commonwealth Games gold medal in the 4x200 freestyle.
So he swims on.
He doesn't go home empty handed.
No, he doesn't.
But has he ever won a gold medal individually? In
the 1500, no. I'm pretty sure he's won world short course championships.
I love him. He's always so fully committed, and he's always so dignified, and he's always just always in there. I love him. Short course,
does that mean they don't have to swim as far?
Yeah.
They swim twice as many laps as a 25-metre pool, but distance. Twice as many turns.
Another highlight, Nicole, did you see the cycling? There was a great stack, which you always love in the cycling.
And was that on the track or the road?
No, it was on the
velodrome.
That's the one. And a woman came over, and they think she broke her collarbone, and one of the Malaysian officials sprinted across and just bent down and checked the number on her back. And everything done by the book. That was a highlight. But what other highlights for you?
Elena Burns, she won the points race over there, the bike rider. That was great. And cramping.
She said she was going to die. She was on the ground saying, I'm going to die.
It was just so hot there. I mean, the humidity was like 90%. So
I think that was because
really
Charlie,
hard.
What's his name, was bending.
Charlie Walsh was grabbing her.
A couple of quick things, the cycling, the Lucy Tyler Lewinsky
story.
I know that we've made a bit of a joke about it, and I know that her reaction post-race has lost a little bit of her credibility, but I really do think there is something that needs to be looked at by the powers that be, whether it be the Sports Commission. If an athlete in any sport has a gripe or has a problem, it needs to be investigated. Mm. Having a loose pedal should not happen at a Commonwealth Games.
Well, twice
it should not it. Happen.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, two pedals came out.
And Cathy Watt missed the start.
She was late.
Yeah, I mean, she was probably concentrating on something else right before, like getting drinks or whatever, but on a start of something like an individual pursuit, it shouldn't happen.
Is it also this thing that, for instance, that interview, that doorstop with Lucy Tyler Sharman just after the race where she was just, like, clearly speaking her mind? Mm. Yeah. Athletes are really vulnerable then. You must get them when they're cool, so.
It's an immediate reaction, and obviously she was disappointed. Mm. I mean, it's the first time at a Commonwealth Games for Lucy. She's now an Australian citizen.
Yes. Yeah.
And it was disappointing for her. So you got her immediate reaction. But mind you, one of the print journos was the one that brought up the sabotage.
She was led that way.
The reaction was led that way. Sure, she would have been angry, but that reaction
the seed was planted.
Do you think there's going to be a really high expectation for the Olympics now? 80 gold medals? Do you think we're under a bit of pressure?
I don't think we'll get 80 gold medals. There will be a lot of pressure. But
I mean, like on Shervington, for example. You know, it's just like...
If he was the second fastest white guy, who was the fastest white guy? Who was he?
A Speedy Gonzales.
Quickly, Float Joe dying. Did everyone just go, whoa?
Yeah, I heard about it 4 a.m. yesterday morning getting a bus to the airport. Jane Fleming told me. And
did you go, whoa?
Yeah, majorly. Because whether or not she took drugs, it's still a very well-known athlete to all of us that's died. She's a mother, she's a wife. Mm. Well, she was a mother, she was a wife. So there's quite a few people that are affected by it. But it's certainly going to be something that is talked about for a long time, and I guess autopsy results will come out. But
Can I just ask a question about that? Let's assume that she did take drugs, okay? Is she still a fantastic athlete? Or by taking drugs, does that really give you an edge?
Well, if we look at the East Germans and the Chinese who we know, have taken drugs, I think that makes them cheaters.
I know it makes them cheaters, but are they still great athletes?
Well, if you look at 84, where she won a silver medal and then came up in 1988 and won a gold medal and went 10.49, well, she went 10.49 in the trials, the US trials. I mean, she wouldn't have gone that fast, presuming she did take drugs.
Yes.
But the interesting thing is that we never really hear about athletes dying from drug abuse. They say it's bad for you, and they say don't do it because you'll die.
It's like your Brenner, don't smoke, don't take drugs.
Yeah.
Exactly. Nicole, congratulations on a sensational job over there. Thank we love the last one.
Thanks for coming down too.
Thank you for coming. Would you please thank Nicole Stevenson? And we'll be back with heaps more panel right after this break. we're back. You're watching the panel, and, well, 10 days to go till the federal election. Santo, an interesting candidate has popped his head up.
Well, actually, he's not a candidate for the federal election, but he still makes me laugh. This was on Saturday's Good Weekend. Does anyone know who Jeff Knuth is?
I've got a suspicion.
That's his real name. Can we just show a picture of Jeff? His nickname is actually Farr.
Yes. Okay, thank you very much.
Anyway, Jeff is the One Nation MP for the seat of Burdekin in Queensland, and he hopes one day to become the state's Minister for Aboriginal Affairs. If he does, he'll try to implement his plan to have rural Aborigines return to the old system of working without pay for white pastoralists. This would eliminate Aboriginal land grabs, as they would camp, as of old, beside station billabongs.
See, that's also the sort of comment that is unifying the country against him.
But hang on, it's also going to eliminate problems with alcohol because without pay, they can't buy any. Knuth seems to genuinely believe this would constitute a return to, quote, traditional way of life. And this is quite... They've tried to become white by adopting a flag and electric guitars and that. But it'll never
seriously
work.
Yeah, no.
The chunky ex-painter and decorator clasps his hand deferentially while demonstrating how a back-to-the-billabong black might approach a pastoralist. Quote, he might say, "G'day, my name's Billy. This is my wife and family. Would you mind if we lived on your land? We don't want to take your land off you, but would it be all right if we did some work for you and all you do is give us a bit of meat or that?"
Seriously, underneath all that is one of the problems I have is that our senior politicians then grandstand and say, "This is a man that..." Our generation just laugh at it.
Yeah, exactly.
It's just think it's stupid.
Best response.
I would like to see that guy at the United Nations. just want to see him make the speech.
Oh, I still want him elected.
Goes without saying. Time to talk television with our regular television correspondent, Jeff Jenkins. Jeffrey, what's been happening in the world of TV?
Well, the Commonwealth Games, we just spoke to Nicole. She was great, too. Yep. Those poolside interviews were fantastic.
Absolutely.
She really had the insight.
I reckon they should have stayed, Nine should have stayed for the riots, because she could have interviewed the people who got beaten up. How are you feeling?
Well, that would have been just as wet.
Oh, yeah, exactly. Phil, that's just my thought.
We were dubious about the Commonwealth Games, how big they were going to be. They were huge.
Yes. Yep.
Ratings bigger than Atlanta for Channel 9, so they are wrapped. Almost twice as big as Nagano for 7. So it shows that we love to see Aussies win.
Is it promotion or is it the actual product? What do you reckon?
I think it's the fact that we're winning.
Yeah.
We like that. Nagano, the big problem was like, who are these guys?
Yeah,
we're coming 20th.
You get home and you'd hear on the news that we hadn't won anything that day and you'd go,
exactly.
Well, I watched that night.
But also, the people they get to anchor it have got... I mean, Eddie's been in sport all since he was in the womb and, you know what, they know how to do it and you know what they also do is they concentrate on sport. They just go bang, 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 over to here.
And they also didn't fill their studio up with Malaysian plants. In Nagano, no more of those little trees. No, I don't want to see them anymore.
Also swimming.
Yeah. And swimming.
Mm. Yeah. There's something about swimming that you can watch.
Yes, as opposed to ice skating or something, which is just an alien sport to us in many ways.
I love ice skating, Tom.
But as well as the coverage, a highlight for me was all the ads. You know, you watched about 100 hours of it. You saw those ads so many times. Mm. Chesty Bond, how good is he? He should get his own show.
Oh, yes.
The Burley Sports Bra ad, that was just a ripper.
Yep.
Now,
and again, you could show breasts because they were clever, weren't they? Because you showed breasts because it was sort of black and white, a bit X-ray-ish. Mm. And also it was sport. It wasn't a gratuitous. Clever. No. Clever
it's not arousing when it's sport.
No.
No, I found it mildly arousing, but anyway, it's just me.
And Channel 9 were pushing
Nikki
for a night.
Have you got penises, Kate? No, no.
Please. Sorry, Jeff, carry on.
Nikki for a night. Has anybody applied to be Nikki for a night?
Oh, I didn't know about this.
Oh, they pushed it very hard.
Oh, I didn't know.
You have to be pregnant, Kate.
You get to go into the gift shop and do the...
Yes, because Nikki is going off to have her second baby, so you can get to be Nikki for a night.
You could really just pre-record it, couldn't you?
Yeah.
Like, you could just rehash it. What exactly does Nikki for a night mean?
She should do it while she's having the baby.
Oh, there could be a cross.
Are people bidding for it?
You have to do a 30-second video, send it into Grundy's. Now, because of the sexual discrimination laws, you don't have to be a woman.
Right.
So anybody can apply.
Yeah. Yeah. Hey, listen,
it could be a big break.
If they don't end up with someone blonde, tall and thin... Mm.
Yes, Jen and out.
We're all hanging to find out who it is.
No. they'll get some kid. I reckon they'll get some kid. Mm-hmm. They might even get some kiddie in a wheelchair. They might go that far. Or they'll get some nana. They'll do, you know, that sort of heart-rending thing. That's what I reckon they'll
well,
do.
Well, stay
some
tuned.
To wait and
some
see.
Nana. Yeah. They'll get nana.
But you know what I reckon, Kate? The reason they're really doing it is so people will talk about it and we're not going to fall.
No, that's right. Forget that.
Moving right along.
Jeffrey, please.
Alongside all those ads were ads for Channel 9 shows that are coming up. So it's really rejuvenated the TV schedules, all the new shows, because they've used the Commonwealth Games to launch some new shows. Mm. I sort of have a long memory. 1990 was the last time Channel 9 did the games from Auckland. And I remember in the ads they pushed one show in particular. It was Family and Friends.
Ah.
So not a good omen.
Oh, that's true.
People probably don't remember that one.
We do.
There's only one person laughing, and that's Jane Kennedy.
Who actually auditioned for a lead role in the...
Taurus Rising was
the Taurus Rising.
Yeah, with the battling family.
Yeah, but that's back in the... Yeah. Like, Mexico...
Before 1990. But Stingers, they're pushing in a big way, the new undercover cop series.
Enough cop shows.
Yeah, it's either cops or medical, isn't it?
Absolutely. Just enough. We've got Murder Call and Blue Heelers and Water Rats.
What do you want? You just want fishing kind of shows.
I want There's the gratuitous video. Now.
What do you reckon, Kate? You're a writer of this sort of stuff. What would be a good source of drama?
Well, see, I don't know. I don't have a very good drama head because I've written Neighbours, which, as we know.
Yeah, but...
You know, I don't know. I don't really get into those one-hour dramas.
Yeah. But just cops, murder as a premise. I mean...
So over the police.
I reckon it's all murder.
A fire station.
A fire station?
Yeah.
Just a slight...
They did that already.
Yeah, fire. Peter Fox was in that one, too.
Peter Fox was in that.
Fire, of course.
So what's a premise? Cops... Fire or hospitals.
Or
what
lawyers,
else is there?
Or lawyers.
Which is
sort of
American brothel?
A brothel?
Well, we've got the set. Exactly. Hey, just quickly, Tom, you've got a body double, someone... We all love lookalikes.
Oh, please.
And this got sent in during the week, someone's brother. Have we got it on the...
On the screen, go have a look at my...
Ray, the director, said to me, I've got it.
Oh!
Jeez, look
freaky?
At that.
Goodness gracious.
From Christine Bale.
Absolutely.
How good is that? That's like a that body double.
Look, they're melting
right,
together.
Don't do that. It's
that
scary.
That's enough. Thanks, Ray.
Ray's got this new machine. He's going, no, I'm not letting go.
The other shows that Channel 9 were pushing, they kicked off tonight. Stingers is next Tuesday night. Changing Rooms tonight. Now, this, I reckon, was the TV disappointment of the year. Mm-hmm. I had a look at it before I came in.
Yeah.
And I just thought it was going to be wall-to-wall nudity.
It's a great
I thought they were going to do... I thought it was going to be hidden cameras in a change room.
Yeah, nice idea. It's
but
a format they've pinched...
It's interior decorating.
It's a format they've pinched from... Well, not pinched, but they've...
From England.
From England. And this is where Nine often go wrong, because Nine are a very conservative network, and they never like to try something new out. They always want to see where it's worked before. Don't forget your toothbrush springs to mind. Kills over there. Thank you. Bring it out here. Just doesn't... It
You're too diplomatic, Tom. Borrowed means actually taking and then saying, here it is back.
Yeah, maybe, but sometimes they pay program
rights.
Yeah,
that's right. Like, they probably bought the format.
Format rights.
Yeah, but I just think often these... I don't know, Changing Rooms is probably a huge...
I'll give you one that did work. Rolf Harris in Britain did Animal...
Hospital, that's right. And they used
came over here. And then... And was RPA another one that was done in
probably.
Britain?
Probably.
Well, what, Funniest Time Videos?
Funniest Time Videos,
In Italy...
Hey, it's Saturday. No, listen. Done in Britain before.
It was not.
No, but you know what could take... In Italy, Man O Man copied in Italy. Man O Man was called Beata Fra Le Donne, which means blessed amongst women.
I think they should have done Changing Sexes.
Yes,
nice idea. That would have been a good one.
No, they did that on RPA.
And the other show...
I waited to do that joke. I thought they'd finish. I could do my funny Changing Sexes joke, and it didn't.
The other show that kicked off tonight was Airport, which is a documentary at Heathrow Airport, another English show. Mm-hmm. A few people were confused when they were shooting the pilot, but anyway.
Yeah.
Roseanne.
Jim. Have you got writers working for you?
You know when that happens, oxygen mask should drop.
Can we get into the brace position?
Should have warned you, but...
Last one, come on.
Next week,
out in a big note.
High noon, we've got Roseanne in one corner, Carrie Ann in the other, and we've got a clip from the new Roseanne show.
Gee, who's screening Roseanne? Is it 10?
Yeah, 10.
With a Howard Stern filter.
Because if I was not hosting this talk show, I know I would be at home in bed watching every other talk show until I got up to 9,000 pounds. all I have ever really wanted to do was to talk directly to you without any middleman.
Before we elected him, we knew he was lying about relationships.
Right.
Okay? So this is, now he didn't lie to the country. Nixon screwed the country. I don't know a man in the world who, if you said to him, did you have an affair with that woman? Would say, well, yes, I did. You could go into the man's room. The woman could be on her knees. You could say to that man, who is that woman? That man will say, what woman?
You know, she has a history of doing stand-up. I mean, that's where she started. She, oh, yeah. on her day, is very funny, I might say.
Which one? Whoopi or... Well, both, I guess.
Both. Roseanne is very funny.
One to watch.
So that kicks off on Monday.
Yes.
Up against Kerri-Anne.
You're on 10. On very 10. Interesting.
Goodbye to Sally, Jesse, Raphael.
There you go.
Oh, thank goodness.
Big, busy TV, as
thank
always.
Goodness.
Would you please thank Jeff Jenkins for joining us?
This sports report brought to you by Portfolio from...
We're back. You're watching the panel and the very special guests just keep on coming. A little over a year ago, this woman was standing at tad over 29,000 feet above sea level. She's the first Australian woman ever to climb Mount Everest. She's just written a book about this and some of her other great climbs called The Wind in My Hair. Would you please welcome the owner of that hair, Brigitte Muir. Thanks for coming back. Now, 97 was your fourth attempt at Everest, is that
right? That's right, yeah.
What happened with the first three?
Okay. How much time have we got?
Yeah, just the brief version.
Okay, 93, the weather was really bad and I was really scared of the mountain, so I didn't go really far. Uh-huh. 95, the weather was perfect, but I had lots of trouble with climbing partners.
Right.
96, the weather was all right most of the time, except when everybody went for the summit and then thing went really, really wrong.
Oh, that was that terrible year.
That's right.
Yeah.
Was that when the 11 people died?
Yeah. Oh, that's right, yes. Yeah. Good wise not to go up there, absolutely.
Well, I wasn't the actual. Right.
What's amazing is that when you go for the summit, though, you head off at, 11 o'clock at night in the darkness with a headlamp.
That's right.
Yeah. And that brought you unstuck once, didn't it?
Well, yeah, once in 95 I was going for the summit and my head torch went out and I tried to change the bulb and the batteries and it didn't work. Mm. And I was left on my own in the dark for about 3 hours before light came and I got really, really cold. And
did you spend the night out?
Yeah.
Now, 70% of people die if they spend the night, is that right?
Yeah, well, fortunately I didn't have a whole night.
Just 3 hours.
Probably saved my life.
Oh, right.
And so what do you do when you're waiting for 3 hours? Do you sit? Do you walk? Do you...
Well, it was a very small area where I was sitting. It was probably about as big as this newspaper here. So I could just sit there and move my arms like this and then my legs the same way to try to stay awake. Because if you fall asleep when you're very cold, chances are that you won't wake up again. And also I was just scheming again because I wanted to go down to the last camp and come back up with more oxygen and a climbing partner and try again.
Yes.
It didn't happen that way.
Now, oxygen, some purists claim, don't they, that you shouldn't climb Everest unless you can do it without oxygen. Is that being a bit fanatical?
I think it is. It certainly is good if you're able to do it without oxygen, but that would mean that a lot of people wouldn't be able to go there and do it. And why should we put rules like that on things, you know?
Well, okay, we walk up there with jackets. We don't do it naked.
That's true. And also shirts.
Although that would be quite an achievement.
Quite a sport. Now, making to the top of Everest was the seventh in you. You wanted to hit the seven biggest mountains on the seven continents.
Yeah.
Kosciuszko must have been a breeze for you.
Oh, it was the hardest.
Is that right? Seriously? But you walk up there and picnic, don't you?
They have a chairlift.
Not if you do it the hard way.
Is that right?
Which is 1,700 metres vertical height.
Yeah. Right.
And it's even harder if you take a bottle of whiskey along.
There's a tip for any budding climbers.
I used to see all those Peter Stuyvesant ads. Did you ever get to the top and just have a cigarette? No, it never happened.
No, I didn't, but my husband John and Clan Everest too had a Marlboro on the side.
Seriously?
Really?
You are kidding. Seriously.
I send the kids to school. To bed, I'm sorry.
That's fantastic.
He needs the oxygen all the time, whether he's mountain climbing.
Did he
or
do
not?
That before or after? Did he put the flag up? Did he even put a flag up?
I think his words on the summit were, when I got there, I felt like having a piss, so I had a piss. And I felt like having a cigarette, so I had a cigarette.
Did he write his name?
That's beautiful.
I think you ran out of material.
that is lovely.
I'm a really keen reader of books on Everest, and one of the things that I can't imagine what it must be like is Everest is a real summit, isn't it? It's like mm-hmm. it's like this table. Mm. You actually get to the top and you go, I'm definitely at the top. And
oh, yeah. Fine.
There's a pointy bit.
There's yeah. a pointy yeah. bit.
It has velvet on the top.
No,
no
it doesn't. Do you, even with the oxygen deprivation, do you sit there and go, this is the most marvellous moment of my life?
No, I didn't. I was really quite stuffed when I got there.
Really?
Yeah, and I just I arrived on the summit and I just dumped my pack and I took my oxygen mask off and left all that behind and I reached inside my pack and got my climbing partner out. And there she is now.
Oh, wow.
This is Sheila Koala, the first koala to climb Everest.
Isn't that right?
Yeah.
And you actually went along, you had some Nepalese guides?
Yeah, I was climbing with two... Sherpas.
Right, yes. And what is the etiquette with the guide? Do you tip them when you hit the summit? Is that is there any sort of etiquette, or are you allowed to just, you know?
Oh, we just hugged, actually.
Fair enough. If you're at the summit, if you're like at the very top, you could be on one side, you could make the puppet come up the other, couldn't you?
Well, you made it. Well done. From China.
Can I ask, there's a very a bestseller in the world now mm-hmm. called Into Thin Air by John mm-hmm. Krakauer. Was in that 96 expedition. It is an extraordinary read. One of the things that I was amazed reading your book is that you were on the South Col, which is at 26,000 feet, through all that chaos.
Mm.
Tell us something about that night when everyone died. And...
Well, the funny thing was that we didn't know anything about it until about 5 o'clock that morning, which was when it was all over.
Right.
Because it was a very windy and stormy night, and when you get to the camp at 8,000, you're really quite tired.
Yeah.
And you just get into your tent and collapse and make a brew and then go to sleep, or try to go to sleep. And no one ever came to our tent to tell us that there was something wrong.
Right.
So we didn't find out until it was too late. And anyway, if we had found out before
that...
I can't get over that guy. Did the guy who wrote it, was he the guy that made it down?
Yeah, John Krakauer.
Well, how did he write the book if he didn't make it down?
No, but I didn't know. Maybe it was written by somebody who didn't go up. Was that the guy who was blind, basically had to walk?
No. Britt, you actually helped. This is Beck Weathers. And you actually started to help him down the mountain, didn't you?
Mm-hmm. So explain to those who don't know. There was a guy who got left at a certain point.
That's right. He almost made it back to the South Col camp at 8,000 metres, but he was left behind because... Mm. It was a big storm and some people just got left behind, I think. I can't remember really what happened up there.
And they thought he was going to die, didn't they?
They thought he was dead, basically.
So they
left him behind.
He couldn't see.
He was as good as dead.
And his arm was frozen up to here or something like that.
Yeah.
Well, you had them.
That's right, yeah.
And, Brigitte, you run a guiding business with your husband, John. If I had more money than sense and I came to you and said, I want to climb Everest, would you get me up to the top?
Can anyone go?
Oh, I'd tell you, go and get some experience first.
Yeah, you wouldn't take a total rank amateur.
No way.
But people do. There have been expeditions where rich American businessmen who've just dreamed of climbing Everest get taken up, don't they?
Yeah, sure, but they do get some experience before they go,
oh,
okay. too.
Yes, they go ballooning.
Oh, okay, yes. Yeah. The other
there's a very, I found reading all these books, very emotional side to climbing Everest, and one of them is that on that 96 tour, people that you knew, Rob Hall and Scott Fisher, these great mountaineers, were dead up on the mountain.
Mm.
And Ed Vistas, who did that IMAX, was in the IMAX team, actually climbed up. And because it's a very narrow ridge, you actually walk past your dead friends. I mean, it must be an incredible
thing. I think I must have been lucky because I've never seen, in 22 years of mountaineering, anyone dead in the mountains. Yeah. But then...
Robin Kosciuszko, was no one up that way? That's a dangerous mountain.
I know.
Tell me what I saw in the IMAX film. Tell me if this is true or not. Spam. Do you eat spam?
Well, other people do.
They had the staple food of mountain climbers is spam.
Oh, there you go.
Well, tin food is.
That's not true.
What do you want?
I just anything
they were actually
else.
They were flying chicken from Kathmandu by helicopter and fresh bananas and things like that.
Oh, were they?
Yeah. The expensive expeditions, not ours, on the shoestring.
Oh, exactly.
When you've climbed all seven, and I will one day myself, is there a sense at the end of that? Is it hard that you no longer have that challenge? Is there a sense of loss? Do you sort of think, what am I going to do now? You know, build a birdcage or something?
Take up ventriloquism.
No, I was just really happy that I'd finally done what I wanted to do because it took me 9 years and it was very hard to stay that long on the project. And then I felt, I'm a free woman, I can do whatever I want now.
Because I'd use it in arguments with friends, you know. Oh, I'm feeling a bit tired today. Yeah, well, try climbing Everest and see how tired.
Exactly. Yeah. Brigitte, we're going to have to leave there. Good luck with the book. Just great read. The opening line, I don't think it quite gets people in. I woke up coughing. Damn, here we go again. My scarf was full of mucus. Now, I don't know. Call me old-fashioned, but, you know. It's a catchy line. I'll grant you that. Good luck with the book, and thank you so much for dropping by tonight. Would you please thank Brigitte Neal? Panel, time to talk sport. We'll go to Steve Quartermain in just a second, but Santa, you've got some wrestling news.
Oh, look, this is almost becoming like a wrestling corner, but thanks to all the people that send all the letters and stop it, please. I know, Mankind is called Cactus Jack and he's also called Mick Foley. Okay, we know that.
I'm glad now, we cleared that up.
Yes, I know. Now, I showed last week some wrestling where they had barbed wire as the actual ropes.
That was a big surprise.
Now, you think how more outrageous can it get? Well, it can get more outrageous. Have a look at the barbed wire in these matches. It's actually got electric shocks. So this is a sort of an all women's match in Japan. So actually, this was quite an incredible match. Listen to the commentator. Now I was just looking at this, right? Now, the commentator gets really excited, right? Now, and I thought, how excited can you get? And then, as I was looking at some other Cactus Jack stuff, Mick Foley, you know, whatever, Mankind, whoever, and I noticed that they kept using tables in the ring. Tables kept getting smashed, and I thought, that's amazing. And then I just kept on realising, listen to the commentator in this stuff. So I put together a bit of a table medley. Have a look at this.
Oh, using the guardrail as a springboard!
Table medleys I've seen. That's probably the best.
Would you please thank Steve Quartermain?
Quarters, top that. What's been happening in the world of sport?
Well, we'll start with cycling. I know Nikki touched on it earlier, but the Australian cycling, be fair to say, is in turmoil at the moment. Look, it should all come to a head probably in October when the Australian Institute of Sport are going to conduct an investigation or inquiry into the world of cycling. It follows the Commonwealth Games with the Lucy Tyler Sharman situation when she's alleged sabotage and nobbling, etc. Look, at therein lies the dilemma. Charlie Walsh has been, there's Charlie there, coach of the Australian cycling team for almost 20 years. His results have been absolutely outstanding until the last couple of years. We underachieved at the Commonwealth Games. We won 8 gold. Mm. We really should have just about clean sweeped it. 96 at the Olympics wasn't all that great. We still did okay. But Charlie Walsh, I've been speaking to a few cyclists the last couple of days who are under Charlie Walsh at the moment and who were or have been under Charlie Walsh. You either love the man or you hate him. He's a hard man, he does it his way, always has, but in the last couple of years he has become a bit more flexible, and especially with the older cyclists, but it's like any coach. I mean, he's not always going to be liked by his...
Simo in the Australian cricket team had exactly the same thing.
Football
that was
coach,
divided
tennis
right
coach,
down the middle, yeah.
And there really is a quandary at the moment. He's been there a long time. A lot of the cyclists say he should still be there. His results are excellent, but there's other chain of thought that maybe his time is up. But a lot of people, as many people dislike Charlie, there's a lot more people that actually like him.
Mm. So here's the quandary, I reckon. It's like if in football, all codes of football in Australia, you are perfectly comfortable with the coach doing this and getting into the players and all that kind of stuff. Mm. And there's a sea change with whole coaching towards technicians and all that.
Yep.
But still, the Don Talbots and the Charlie Walsh, all these sort of people, when you add it up, their records are frighteningly good.
Mm. They are, and you cannot argue with that.
Yeah. So therefore, you know, when all the technique and all the lactic acid's been measured and all of that, passion and firing people up still matters, and that's why they'll always get a job.
Well, Neil Fraser was like 18 semi-finals in 20 Davis Cups and stuff.
Right.
And just something, a sideline to that, it appears that perhaps Charlie Walsh may be taking legal action against Tyler Sharman, and perhaps Darren Hill as well. I mean, that's not been confirmed, but of what they were alleging over the Commonwealth Games.
It was pretty explosive stuff. There was no legends about it.
No, but look, Charlie Walsh has got a lot of fans out there. He's got a few detractors, but he's also got a hell of a lot of fans from the current cyclists and cyclists that have been under him. So it'd be interesting, this inquiry, which will probably happen in October. Cricket Australia is, as we speak, on their way to Pakistan. The first game's on a Friday.
Do you believe... be weird, though. I mean, this is... Wasn't Macram is on the verge of either being kicked out of the sport or...
Well, wasn't Macram retired? Not anymore. He's come out. He's now said, I'm back. I'm ready for selection.
Why until his name is cleared, which will take him till he's 700 from the sound of things?
Yeah. Australia's won one series in Pakistan in 40 years, and we've only won ever two tests there in history. So if Australia can go on and win over there...
Well, they should have a quiet word in the Pakistan.
I know.
So the one-day team from the Commonwealth Games is going straight to Pakistan.
No, the Australians, four or five Australians left yesterday. Mm-hmm. They met up with the Aussies in Kuala Lumpur, and they're now jetting off to Pakistan. So good luck to the Aussies, and if they can win over there... Well, they already are the best team in the world, but they can really enhance their
reputation.
Well,
they got the silver medal, hey?
Flojo. Unfortunately, as we know, she died yesterday at the age of 38. Well, you look at her record, she's one of the most amazing athletes in Olympic history. Three gold medals. There's Flojo. This is an 80. Of course. Now, look, her times then were superhuman. And look, there was many male athletes in 1988 that would have been happy with her times at the Olympic Games. It really was a superhuman effort. Only Marion Jones, who recently has got close to her a couple of times. But it's 10 years now for those world records in the 100 and 200. All the innuendo, look, there all has been talk about steroids, human growth hormone. But the thing is, and we talked about Michelle Smith, the swimmer. Mm. She has undergone so many drug tests, did Flojo in her time. She never tested positive. So you have to say that even though there's all the suspicions, and I'm as suspicious as anyone, but she always passed the tests. Right. So
and
you've got to say
problem,
she was just
it?
A
She's
freak.
A what if you're a sensational athlete and you smash all these records rather than just receiving accolades and going down in history as a great legend?
To me it sounds like even the people that were very close to her friends sort of... I mean, even Carl Lewis in his book alludes to the fact that it was all a bit weird.
It's a hard one. Now the fact that she's passed on at only 38, I mean, it's going to be a free-for-all now. Mm.
This is why the drugs is the cancer of all...
Yeah,
it is.
Right. It's a wake-up call.
And it's only going to get worse.
Because, you know what, it undermines our perception of the...
Yeah,
the
well, every time an athlete wins a medal now, no matter what competition, you always automatically think... suspicious. I mean,
but it's like Nicole was saying before, it's like it kills you. Ultimately, people say, not that this has been established, that that's what
killed
her.
No, well, they did an autopsy today, and the cause of death has not been found, so now it's going to take about 2 or 3 weeks when they have a
You know what always
autopsy.
Amazed me about her? Oh, sorry, Glenn.
Well, even if it's not drugs, the thought that maybe it is that a good deterrent? I mean, you know.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
Well, it is. It's a great lesson. I mean, we all know the dangers of steroids, and athletes take that risk, the calculated risk, but it is a dangerous drug. It can cause all sorts of things, from heart problems to cancer.
A 38-year-old super fit person dying is bizarre.
It's scary.
It's scary.
And you know the other amazing thing about her was... And I remember I was been talking with girlfriends about this. You know,
some point
in sports,
at me.
you know, in sports where like 1/1,000,000th of a second counts.
Yeah.
She used to run with those fingernails and the jewellery Surely that must have slowed her
down.
Well,
some people said that she actually did all that to try and take away from the suspicions that she wore.
To make herself look really
outfit.
Feminine.
She looked very feminine, very heavily made up. I was about 20 metres away from her in 88 in Seoul, watching her run. And some people said that she, in fact, did that to try and take away the...
Right. There's a bit of Janet Jackson about her, I reckon. I think there is. I've got to bring something up, Steve. I don't want to prolong this argument or anything like that, but I did receive something from a fellow called Jim during the week.
Yes.
And he told me, could you remind Steve... Mm-hmm. This is all about the Mark Filippucci
thing,
okay?
Yes, I'm aware, aware of that.
And certain people were critical of the fact that he said he wouldn't play Davis Cup. Now, was his reason because he wanted to further his own professional career before he played for Australia? I think he may have.
Well, that might have been early on in the case, but I know the big spat that they had was the fact about that Mark Filippucci's claim that Nuke to a lesser extent Tony Roach, for not supporting him when he was going through some personal
crisis.
Yeah,
but his official reason was, I need to follow my personal career at the moment. Mm-hmm. Now, when Luke Longley refused to play for Australia in basketball in the World Championships in Greece, his statement, well, even though the Chicago Bulls had finished for the season, he said, look, I need to sort of further my own career.
Yes, that's
and
correct.
He wasn't criticised for that.
Well, he was criticised.
Was he? Oh, I don't know.
Luke Longley had a difficult situation where he was out of contract. Now, Luke Longley's probably going to get a contract now worth $15 million conservatively over 3 years.
Yeah.
Now, if Luke Longley had gone to the World Championships and got injured,
right,
there was a potential of him not being picked up.
Oh, so you're putting the money ahead of the playing for Australia.
Correct, yes. Yeah. No, right. And that's already been documented.
But send that back to Jim.
Yeah, okay, Jim, there you go.
So it's a difficult situation. But, I mean, Luke Longley has... I mean, he probably cost us a medal at the Atlanta Olympics because he didn't take part.
Oh, so you are having a go at Luke.
Yeah.
I'm just stating, in fact,
if Luke Longley had been in the Australian team in 96, we would have got probably a bronze or a silver medal.
Mm-hmm. And in the Olympics, was there something happening? Oh, he was injured.
In 96, no, yeah. 96, I'm talking
about. Oh, you're talking
about Atlanta. So it is a quandary.
Sorry,
quickly,
carry on.
That's all right. Ben Johnson, of course, we're talking about drugs in sport. He went back to court yesterday to try and get a court order to compete again. He's 36 years of age. This was my best moment in sport. I was right trackside watching this. It was also my worst moment in sport. He ran 9.79 this day. He was so full of drugs, it's amazing he survived just another couple of months. He came back in 93, tested positive again, got banned for life, and he's trying to have that overturned now. Don't bother, he's 36, he's too old, and he's not wanted.
He should go to Judge Judy.
Yes.
I reckon that's where he should go.
And before we go, footy, grand final week, of course, in the NRL and the AFL. Yep. Good luck to North Melbourne, Adelaide, Canterbury and Brisbane, whatever they do this weekend. Speaking of footy, it could only happen in America. A fight during a college game between Southern University and Prairie View, not involving the players, but the two music bands. The two music bands, and this is a fair dinkum fight, they caused thousands of dollars of damage to their uniforms and their musical instruments.
Check out the tuba.
And look at this player. You wanted to go on with the clarinet player.
This is the best. Oh, no, they didn't show the tuba. The tuba was all bent. The guy was walking
around
the bent.
They faced the tribunal, and both bands have been suspended for 2 weeks. Fair dinkum. That's true.
Another huge week in sport. Would you please thank Steve Quartermain for dropping by this evening? With some more panel right after this break.
Good evening, I'm Tracy Spicer. Coming up in 10's Late News, Labor launches a...
Watching the panel and our mugs tonight. Our mug sponsors are Studio Commercial, who specialise in corporate and editorial product photography, and they've sent $500 to the Red Cross. Thank you, Studio Commercial.
Do you
Commercial.
Reckon that they'll ever drug test TV people? In time? Because I reckon if it was steroids, they'd take one look at us, strip down and go, don't bother.
Next.
No, you're not taking it.
Yeah, right, you're safe.
I wouldn't mind a full body search or something.
Now, is that seriously done, though? Does anyone know the answer to this question?
What?
Customs.
Full body search, yeah.
Cavity search. Yes. It really can happen.
Yes.
Obviously, they've got to be suspicious.
Not, yeah,
they've got,
they,
it's
be.
Not that they just pluck you off at
I've
random.
I've got friends who have done it as practical jokes. And nothing's ever happened. Like, they've called the airport when friends are going overseas and gone, oh, yeah.
Hey, Davo's going overseas
and he's got a lot of drugs on him. Yeah. But nothing's ever happened. I mean, customs just go, good on you.
I don't think you can request a search like that. I think it works that way.
Yes, we'll put you down for a... what time's he coming through? Is that a two, is it? Okay. Give you a table by the window. That'd be nice. Have you seen the HBA ads? Always fun to watch. Normally in the ads, the people nearly get hurt. Now, in the new one, they're using some footage you may have seen before. It's got a Commonwealth Games theme. Let's have a look at it.
Oh, no, I've seen it. I know what's happening. I know what's about to happen.
Oh, my God.
I remember that.
He's sitting there going, la 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 la.
But
bullshit.
But Glenn, you know what? When I originally saw that, you know what I actually thought? I thought, you know what? That's an interesting element to the javelin.
Yes.
Why don't you have a target as well?
A moving target.
You should have to hit something, otherwise... Because it's like taking a sport to its origins, yeah.
If he had run off, right? Does that, and then it fall and down over there? There's a record.
You know? I reckon just let a herd of Hereford cattle out there.
Yeah.
Because they're going to, you know, we're going to kill them anyway.
Yeah. I reckon that the criterion for that sport should be if it lands, it has to go.
Was
good
that,
thinking.
Was that an ad?
That is an ad. And
so
yeah.
It went on to go.
Anyway, interesting.
Sensational. I received a piece of mail this week. Kate, you'll be interested in this.
Oh, I hate it when you say things.
That's putting the
this came from Dave. He only wants to be known as Dave.
Yeah.
Please find enclosed a brief but revealing excerpt from Kate Langbrook's now infamous appearance on Chances.
Oh, we were doing that this month. I don't think I actually want to see
well,
this.
Well, you haven't been asked.
Excuse me.
Who watched all of the
Clinton
thing?
I don't know whether to thank you for that or be insulted by that.
Unfortunately, the copy is poor due to my reception of Channel 9 at the time. I recorded it, and the fact that I twice hit record a few seconds too late. He was excited, obviously. Listen, this is where it gets tragic. I have a large collection of videos upon which I've recorded all manner of stuff, useless and otherwise. Included in this stuff is virtually every major nude scene from Chances.
Oh.
I am a big, fat, dirty perv. This is true, and he goes on to explain that...
I wish John Howard would stop writing to us.
Goes on to explain that so his mum didn't find all this stuff, he'd label it very sort of covertly with various buzzwords just to remind him, you know, of what was on the tape. I had to find some appropriate buzzwords description for that tape's list. It may or may not be of value to Kate to know that my entry for her scene was Chances, Fabo Titties. Now, is that a compliment or is that a compliment?
Yeah.
Well, I don't think we'll play it tonight because we're running late, and I think we'll have to give cut. No. No. Enthusiastic.
Do you know
anyway.
What I'm quite pleased about? That this must be how chivalrous Australian manhood is,
yes.
That it's taken this long for one, what does he call himself, dirty pervo,
dirty fat perv, yeah.
To send it in.
Yeah. Oh, no, we've had a dozen.
This is the best entry.
I'll tell you something, look, I will change subjects, but not too much so that everyone won't be disappointed. But there's this great thing called the Durex 1998 Global Sex Survey, and it's a great piece of advertising, isn't it? Because people actually say, in a recent survey by Durex, but how about this for a fact? Australians are prolonging their lovemaking up to 22.6 minutes from 22.7 in 1997, and that result excludes foreplay. So 22. But it does include going down to the lounge room to watch the sports report.
Because I have a stopwatch there, and I go, record time, yes.
But it's good. It's got. Like,
Australians have been voted the best lovers, along with the French.
Is that right?
And interestingly, the Latin lovers, Spain and Italy, come in 9th and 10th.
Oh. Well, so you
and you know what's really sad about it?
What?
You come in behind Britain.
Don't you ever say that.
That's true. You come in behind Britain. They're saying Italy and Spain are worse at doing the job.
It is it is no surprise to Australian women that Australian men come first.
A bit of shtick. Let's show the tape. Come on. Okay, let's go.
No.
But don't you find sex surveys a bit
stupid, and also because what is the topic most people lie about?
Yeah, but hang on. People don't really talk about it that much, so you might be interested how many times people do it week.
I think the most interesting thing was that survey that came out. That I'm arguing against my point.
was that
women find listening to music more enjoyable than sex?
Was that in the survey?
That was part of the survey. You didn't get to it, obviously.
We didn't read it, obviously.
I must have been reading the Star Report at the time.
You're editing the wrestling at the time.
So I agree. Surveys are done. When you tune into a news and you hear a new survey today, you know it's just a dud.
Well, unless you break it down into age groups and things like that.
In one of them, it was the factors most important when making love. Half the people said satisfying my partner, and Porter said satisfying myself, and one bloke said make sure the president of Mexico doesn't actually come into the Oval Office.
Okay, on that note, we're going to have to wind it up here.
Yes.
Ladies
and gentlemen, Santo Chilaro, we take you out. That is about it. We're out of time.
Emergency.
We are out of time. Thank you for tuning in this evening. Thank you to our special guests tonight, Nicole Stevenson and Brigitte Muir, all our regulars. Tracy Spicer coming up next with the news. See you next week. Right here on the panel. Santo Chilaro. So shame.